The forest industry has long been one of Oregon's economic mainstays. Earlier this year, our City Club Research Committee on Economic Development, Forest Products Sector, reported that in 1985, Oregon was the top producer of lumber and plywood in the nation, producing 23% of all U.S. lumber. Also, they reported that one-third of all of our manufacturing jobs in the state are in the forest products industry, approximately 75,000 jobs with a $1.8 billion annual payroll. Today, it is known that the supply of timber from private timberlands is diminishing and won't support industry needs for another 15 or 20 years. This is forcing increased reliance on public timberlands for saw logs. Public forest lands are subject to numerous competing uses, ranging from timber supply to wildlife habitat. This raises the specter of the adequacy of the timber supply to support the manufacturing employment base in Oregon. Today's speaker will address this issue from an insider's perspective. He has been involved in the wood products industry for nearly 40 years. He was born in Tacoma, graduated from the University of Washington with a bachelor's in economics in 1947, and he immediately saw the light. He moved to Oregon and founded a lumber company. Our speaker is currently chief executive officer of several companies: Hampton Lumber Sales, Hampton Tree Farms, Willamina Lumber Company, Hampton Veneer, and Tillamook Lumber Company. He is the vice chairman and member of the board of the Oregon Forest Industries Council, and he serves on the board of numerous organizations, including the Federal Reserve Bank of San Francisco, the Western Wood Products Association, and the World Forestry Center. John is married and has four children, and I understand his wife Carol and his son David are attending today. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. John Hampton.
I hope this is bulletproof. Fellow City Club members, and I emphasize fellow City Club members, in the faint hope that at the end of my remarks the questions will all be benign and friendly. 6 years is a long time between public statements, but it's a pleasure for me to return here again almost exactly 6 years to the day from the last time I talked to the City Club. There is a lot of material to deal with in that six-year interval, and I've had a difficult time compressing it, although Greg Noakes, whom I see here in the audience today, did a pretty good job for me by writing about a third of my speech in the Oregonian this week. Anyway, I'll try to squeeze 6 years into about half of 60 minutes for you as I take you through some of the significant developments that have occurred during this period. I learned how to do this from Dave Frohnmeyer, who tells a very interesting story on himself. It seems that when he first ran for public office, that Dave was invited to speak at the Grange Hall in Goshen, Oregon, and went down loaded for bear. He arrived on a Sunday night about 6:45 to be sure he wasn't late for his 7 o'clock appointment, and at about 7:15, an old dusty rancher stumbled in, and it became apparent that he was going to be the only person in the audience. So Dave finally shuffled his feet around for a while and asked the rancher what he thought he ought to do. And the rancher said, "Well, son," he said, "I'm just a rancher, and I don't know you, but," he said, if I went out to feed my cattle and only one of them showed up," he said, "I'd feed them." So Dave proceeded with his talk, and he to his one-person audience. So he outlined his economic program for reconstituting the state of Oregon. He talked about special dispensations for the farmers and the ranchers. He talked about educational problems, his vision for the future of Oregon, and so forth and so forth. He went on for about 1 hour and 15 minutes, and he finally concluded with the stirring climax, following which he stepped down off the podium and he said to the fellow, he says, "Old timer," he said, "well, how'd you think I did?" And the old farmer said, "Well," he said, "I'm just a rancher," he said, "I still don't know you very well, but," he said, "if I went out to feed my cattle and only one of them showed up," I sure as hell wouldn't dump the whole load on them. So, in consideration of Dave's experience, I've tried my very best to condense this down to what is meaningful for you. I remember saying one thing during my talk here last time, and that was that I was confident about the future and that we were risking the family farm by making an investment in a new plant at Willamina. I don't think Carol knew when she signed the note just how risky that was at the time. We came a lot closer to the brink than I would have anticipated, because we were really at that time only 1 year into the recession. What I do see at this time, however, is a serious lack of understanding about the recovery that the industry has been making, particularly in the last 3 years in the state of Oregon. There were two polls last year that indicated that most Oregonians felt that the industry was a sunset industry and was still in trouble. And while recently a poll by Bill Moore indicates that more Oregonians are now aware that there has been some change in the forest industry, there are a sizable number of people that are still suffering under the delusion that the forest industry is in a state of disrepair and demise, that it's no longer going to occupy a preeminent position in the economic and social structure of the state of Oregon. And I guess I need to remind you that we are now in the third consecutive year of record setting in terms of lumber production and lumber consumption in the United States. At the end of 1987, we will have consumed 50 billion feet of softwood lumber in the United States, largest single record in the history of the trade. And Oregon is participating fully in this recovery. The housing market has been leading our recovery. It is our largest single market, occupying about 40% of our total products consumed. But close behind that and gaining on that is a very important market segment known as remodeling and repair, which will be even more important to us if people lose their confidence in the economy and begin to defer decisions on new housing. They will stay in their existing residences longer and will tend to spend more money on remodeling and repair. That market has gone from 21% of our total to 30% of our total in the last 2 or 3 years. I think one of the misconception by Oregonians is a product of our own success in explaining to you what serious trouble we were in the early 1980s. We had a very large volume of high-priced government timber sales on the books that we simply could not deal with. Current stumpage prices averaging something like $150 a thousand were represented at that time by values about $400 per thousand. There was no way that the majority of the industry members could operate those contracts without going broke and putting a lot of people out of work. And as a consequence of our public information program, we produced a climate that made it possible for us to pass legislation at the federal level, permitting us to buy out from the federal government some 55% of our timber sale contracts at penalty prices that generated a substantial amount of money to the federal government, instead of leaving them with a lot of contracts that were in default. But I think because we were so successful in disseminating that message, it's been hard for Oregonians to realize that we've had a real revitalization in the state of Oregon, that although we are now employing only 65,000 people directly in the industry instead of the 80,000 that we did before, that we are now more productive and more competitive. A study by Western Wood Products Association has recently revealed that since 1979, mills in the West have increased their production per man hour by 60%, a 60% productivity increase. I think that's a phenomenal increase when you look at the record of the rest of the business in the United States of America. We've done a fabulous job of improving our performance here. I also think it's a credit to the courage of the industry that it was willing to commit itself to substantial budget increases in terms of market development. Western Wood Products Association has budgeted an additional $1 million per year on a program designed to expand markets over the five-year period they're working on by some 2.5 billion feet. The aggregate budget of Western Wood Products Association per year is about $5 million. At the same time, American Plywood Association spends $11 million annually to generate new markets for its plywood products, which are manufactured both in the West and in the South. It isn't easy to spend that kind of money under difficult times, but I think it's a credit to the industry that it tried to give itself some self-help by stepping up to the box and budgeting more money. In addition to that, we had some help with our export markets by the weakening dollar. Our exports went from about a billion nine hundred million feet last year to about 2,100,000,000 feet this year. That's probably not a meaningful number for most of you, but that's a 20% increase in a one-year period in export lumber. Many of our mills, contrary to popular opinion, can cut metric sizes and do cut metric sizes and do it very, very successfully. And to a large extent, that kind of lumber is cut out of old-growth timber, and that's one of the reasons I will talk about old-growth later. Our competition has also changed in this time. Late last year, we negotiated with the Canadians an increased tax on the Canadians of 15% ad valorem on their products. That was a result of an International Trade Committee study that was made, International Trade Commission study, which was made, took about a year and a half to do it. All the while, the Canadians were telling us they were not subsidizing their operators, they were not giving them cheap stumpage. We were arguing that our data indicated that they were doing so, and finally, at the end of about a year and a half of negotiating, they agreed to impose the tax on themselves. That tax of 15% is a humongous amount of money. The British Columbia government has now provided a substitute program for that tax. It is imposing additional costs on industry in British Columbia alone of some $500 million per year. Now, I remind you that the Canadians agreed to do this voluntarily. And whereas they were saying there were no subsidies on stumpage, they negotiated the agreement and imposed the tax on themselves rather than to have our government collect a duty. So I suggest to you that the subsidy is in fact a subsidy no matter what color the code. Increased cost will be more important on difficult markets because it raises the Canadians' break-even cost. And when we get down to the point where curtailment begins to be a decision that has to be made, some of our mills will be operating that would otherwise have been curtailed, and some Canadians will be curtailed that might otherwise have been operating. Furthermore, during the same period of time, we've had some significant remodeling in labor costs in the Pacific Northwest. In the negotiations a couple years ago, 2 years ago, wages and benefits were rolled back by a total of one-third in negotiations with the two major labor unions. Our company had a very bitter strike in 1983, some 13 weeks. We were losing an extraordinary amount of money at the time. We were forced under the labor agreement to increase our per hour costs. I could see that that wasn't sensible. We elected not to go along with the industry package, and we negotiated a reduction of fringe benefits at that time without cutting wages. I might say that we felt that those fringes were excessive. We had employees in our employ who had been with us some time that were receiving 2 months of pay for not working. I suggest that that is excessive, especially when you're losing money. I guess another way to look at it was they were getting more time off than I was. In any event, in subsequent negotiations, the rest of the industry negotiated a reduction of one-third in their labor costs, and it makes our industry considerably more competitive. A lot of money has been invested. Not spent, invested in high technology equipment in our industry during this period. It enables us to recover a significantly larger amount of lumber from the log that we have to pay for. And it's a double whammy because the same people are there, the same overhead is there, but if more lumber comes out the back end of the mill, the unit cost is lower, in addition to providing us with better recovery out of these high-priced logs. We've lost a few mills in the process. Some of them that couldn't afford to remodel, some of them that didn't have the efficiencies are gone. 109 mills less now than in 1979. Interestingly, a number of mills which were shut down, a number of marginal mills have been bought and are operating under new management. We have a phenomenon of one company that is only a little over 3 years old that has bought over 30 mills and started them up and is now operating those mills at a profit. Another transition that has occurred during this time is the deregulation of railroads. The Staggers Act was passed 3 years ago, and it's enabled us to penetrate markets throughout the United States that we had been foreclosed from servicing through the regulation of the Interstate Commerce Commission rate establishing mechanism. Now it is possible for us to negotiate rates with the various railroads. We are transporting lumber from both Tillamook and Willamina by truck to the Union Pacific and Burlington Northern, who are capable of offering us more competitive rates to the Midwest, to the Southeast, and the Northeast than what we are able to get in combination rates with our point of origin on the Southern Pacific. So deregulation has helped us there. On the other hand, we're still working on an exemption for our lumber products from the Jones Act, which precludes us from using competitive foreign cargo carriers to the Gulf and Atlantic Coast markets. There is no cargo service available domestically in American bottoms from the West Coast to the East Coast. But nevertheless, the law precludes anyone from hauling our lumber to the Atlantic Coast except the American bottoms, which are not available. I suggest that is counterproductive. I think another investment that has paid off is the investment in training our supervisors and our managers. You've been reading a little bit in the media recently. I made a talk at Oregon State University a month ago, which I don't know who sent that copy to the Oregonian. There wasn't any reporter in the audience. I screened the audience before I leveled with them. In any event, we have invested a lot of money in training our supervisors. I don't know why we expected them to inherit supervisory skills when we promoted them from the hourly ranks. They were the guys that were tough enough to want to get ahead. They were the ones interested in gaining promotions, and their aggressiveness motivated us to put them in supervisory positions without any particular training in communication skills or management skills. But we've been working very hard on improving our side of the equation so that we can give guidance, assistance, and training to the hourly people on the other side of the equation. It's resulted in better quality decisions. Our communications with our personnel are much better. We have a better collaboration and cooperation. We've also instituted voluntary profit sharing at Willamina. We do not yet have a formula by which this is distributed. I've appointed a committee from our board, including members of our crew, to work on devising a proper formula to distribute profit sharing to our people. If you get the formula wrong the first time, it's a disaster to have to change it. So we hope to do it right by the spring of next year. In the interim period, we have been voluntarily sharing profits with our people. This is a very highly motivating effect. We are paying them union scale as a base, but they have made a significant amount of incremental income as a product of the profit sharing because we are having a very good year, and we have told them that when we make it, you make it. When your productivity is high and our profitability is good, we are going to share with us. There's also been a significant change in plant ownership throughout the state of Oregon. There are a lot of names that were once premier in the state of Oregon that are no longer present. I see Clarence Richin here from Crown's Utterback Company. Crown is no longer on the scene. Crown was the subject of a hostile takeover and has disappeared. Champion International has a reconstituted image. Significant plants have been shut down, and they have been acquired by a number of independent operators, including ourselves. Southwest Forest Industries, who was active in Central and Southern Oregon, has been taken over by Stone Container. Diamond International is different. Brooks Scanlon is gone. Publishers Paper Company is gone. We acquired two of their mills. We've had some significant changes in ownership. As a generality, the smaller independent operators have been able to take these mills and operate them profitably because we are more mobile, we are more responsive, we're closer to the people, we are closer to the decision-making process than is possible by virtue of sheer size for some of the larger companies to get. It's a distinct handicap. It's not their fault. It isn't that they're not good managers. It's simply that as a product of size, you lose your sensitivity, and it's difficult to manage in the same entrepreneurial fashion that the smaller operator can maintain. I'd just like to take a minute and tell you about a textbook case of what can be done with one of these mills. We acquired our Tillamook mill in December of 1986. The mill was started up in March of 1979, mid-March. We did an excruciating job of evaluating personnel and of selecting the people to run that plant. Slightly over one half of the personnel that we hired came from two shifts of production from that mill for the one shift that we are operating. A little less than one half of those people were recruited from other plants through this interview process. We interviewed these people with a very professional grid of data that we accumulated on their work experience and to a very heavy degree attitudinal positions. We wanted people who would be responsive to change, people who were willing to collaborate and cooperate, to listen, to be willing to change. And I'm happy to say that as a product of that very rigorous interview process, that mill is extraordinarily successful. It's operating with 23% better efficiency than the predecessor company was able to get from the people that ran that mill. And we have been able to give those people 5 monthly voluntary bonuses during this period from mid-March until the end of, what month is this? Until, we haven't done November yet, until the end of September. And that's an example of what can be done. I think the key point that I'd like to give you is that the surviving industry is stronger and healthier than it was before we went through this terrible trauma. Our industry trade associations are predicting that next year will be a year of similar consumption to this year. I think the jury is still out on that as a product of the crash of October 19th. Surveys indicate there is a lot of discomfort out there among the consumers. On the other hand, some other surveys indicate that people's building expectations are not that different from what they were before the stock market crash, and that is considered to be a somewhat unique phenomenon that may have nothing to do with our everyday lives, except those of us who have the misfortune to invest in the stock market here temporarily. That isn't me, by the way. I still owe the land bank enough money, I don't have money to invest in the stock market. Some major environmental issues have emerged in the last 6 years, and I have to tell you that I'm increasingly concerned about the misconceptions that are being disseminated by what I construe to be normally responsible environmental groups. For example, at a recent meeting of the Audubon Society in Bellingham, Washington, Brock Evans, the Vice President on National Issues, called for, quote, endless pressure, endlessly applied, to achieve maximum set-asides of old-growth forests in the next 5 years, unquote. He urged the 500,000 member, this is national membership, 500,000 members being exhorted, quote, to give names to as yet unnamed areas of old-growth trees to heighten emotional tensions and to appeal proposed road and timber sale plans, unquote. I suggest that is irresponsible. I'd like to try to put into understandable terms the issue of old growth preservation, and I'm going to read this carefully because I do not wish to be misquoted. I'm not accusing the press of misquoting me, but I think it's easy to hear what you're listening for, and I want to be very careful about this. First of all, in Washington and Oregon, less than 40% of all national forests are being managed for standard timber production under existing plans. 35% of the current national forest land base is off limits to any timber management activities. In Washington and Oregon, over 6 million acres of national forest lands containing standing saw timber is presently off limits to logging under existing forest plans. In wilderness areas alone, in Washington and Oregon, 4.5 million acres of forest lands containing 50 billion board feet of commercial timber is presently permanently set aside. Let me give you a couple of those numbers again. In wilderness areas alone, 4.5 million acres of forest land containing over 50 billion feet of timber is presently set aside. We're never going to run out of old growth in my lifetime, in your lifetime, in the lifetime of your children, your grandchildren. These trees are there permanently set aside in enormous quantities. 50 billion feet exceeds the 10-year harvest of the national forest system in the states of Washington and Oregon combined. I suggest to you that is an extraordinary amount of commercial value to have set aside in preservation in perpetuity. In the state of Oregon, old growth comprises 65% of our total available commercial timber land base. When it is suggested to you that we should stop cutting old growth and should begin cutting second growth, try to remember that 65% of our available timber in the state of Oregon that's available for harvesting is old growth timber. It's imperative that we continue to harvest both second growth and old growth. There was a controversy in the article Greg wrote the other day, and if you choose to ask me about that, I'll answer it later. In the interest of time, I will not give you the details on why there is a difference between the estimates of the number of years of old growth that is outstanding. On the one hand, the State Forester estimates there is 125 years of old growth available if current cutting is maintained, and on the other hand, the Regional Forester is saying about 35 years. But I don't want to get into the details of that because it's somewhat technical. Surely we must remember that over time, the old growth on the commercial forest lands that is not preserved is going to be replaced by vigorously growing second growth that's going to grow more timber per acre than our old growth timber is growing at the present time. And this is constructive. This transition needs to occur. That productive land base is not giving us the outputs that it is capable of growing because of the current cover crop of old growth material on it. Also important, I think, is that many of our old growth mills are dependent on this because of the special products that they manufacture, including those for the export market. Worldwide markets understand the virtues of the kind of product that can be made from this old timber. Those products will ultimately be phased out and replaced with other types of products, but that is not going to happen for several generations because of the transitional period for the old growth change. When someone tries to convince you that the industry is out there mucking up the environment, I would like to suggest to you that you take a ride down the Wilson River Highway or up the Trask River Road to see what kind of recovery nature has made with the assistance of man as a product of the disaster that we had in the Tillamook Burn. Over a period of 24 years at six-year intervals, 355,000 acres of commercial timberland was burnt to a crisp. And through the wisdom of the state legislature and the support of the public, $12 million in bonds was authorized for the replanting of that 355,000 acres. When you see what nature has done in that area with man's help, you will recognize the kind of recovery that our verdant natural resource is capable of doing with a little bit of assistance. The minor impact that we are making as an industry in only harvesting about 1% of our land base per year is infinitesimal compared to the kind of natural disasters this area has suffered. I don't like to have my industry's image distorted by those who claim that we are not responsible stewards of the forest lands. Another allegation that is made is that industry is propagating monoculture through the genetic improvement program that it embraces. I have here for your inspection, if you like, three responsible experts who will explain why the gene pool will in fact be preserved. In fact, that without the kind of genetic improvement program that we are undertaking and the setting aside of these highly productive superior trees in our J.E. Schroeder seedling orchard, that we would in fact be at risk of losing some of the gene pool rather than the reverse, which is being alleged by some of the environmental activists. Let me give you a final example. I think it's deliberately misleading to read a recent call to arms by the Sierra Club Legal Defense Fund. Let me give you an extract from this document. Quote, "Dear fellow citizen, America's forests are under siege. Even as I write this letter to you," and by the way, this is a fundraising letter, "even as I write to you, the chainsaws and bulldozers are at work wiping out stand after stand of age-old, old-growth trees, creating massive forest clear cuts and miles of new roads. Our national forests are complex, fragile ecological systems which the United States Forest Service, according to law, is required to manage for multiple use. That is, the service is supposed to balance the need for lumber with other needs, like the needs of wildlife and recreational needs of people like you and me." Unquote. Now, that description of the Forest Service would appear to be overbalanced in favor of the forest industry. But I have to tell you, I have a somewhat different view of how the Forest Service is dealing with this issue when I look at the draft plans that have been submitted on the new 10-year plans of the National Forest System in this area. Those plans represent a cut in the states of Washington and Oregon, which is Region 6, of a reduction of 25% in timber outputs in this region. I suggest to you it's irresponsible for a prestigious organization like the Sierra Club to be disseminating this kind of misinformation. Times have changed in the forest industry, and I think from what I've described to you, you can see that they have changed for the better in terms of the things that we have done to improve our lot. We are much more efficient and effective. We have a better cost base. The most worrisome thing of all is the cost of our most expensive component of cost, and that is our log cost. Our log costs comprise about 3/4 of our total product cost. We're beginning to see evidence of irrational bidding at the bidding table as we see these forest plans closing in on us with potential reductions of some 25%. Somehow the general public does not seem to be aware of the magnitude of these reductions and how those reductions have the potential of impacting every single person in Washington and Oregon. You may think as residents of the metropolitan area that you are not affected. A recent study by three researchers in Corvallis, whose names are Olson, Shalow, and Mackey, clearly indicate that some 2,000 jobs will be affected within 3 years in the Portland metropolitan area. If you don't think that's a significant number, I would like to remind you of the amount of money that was spent to generate 100 jobs in Millersburg. Almost $6 million of benefits were provided to bring the Japanese to Millersburg. And I say good for them. We need those 100 jobs, and we need them badly. But here we have the potential for losing 2,000 jobs in the Portland metropolitan area if we have these kinds of reductions from the National Forest System. In addition to which, if we don't have competitive raw material costs, we're going to wind up not being able to take advantage of the reductions that are going to come in Canada when they've quit cutting their beetle-killed timber that they're presently forced to harvest at a rate that cannot be supported. Many Oregonians are under the pressure that private landowners can just go out and cut their timber any way they like. I want to just have a little instant survey here. How many of you are aware that if I wish to cut timber on my private tree farm, that I must get a permit from the State Department of Forestry and that I must log it according to the regulations that require protection of the environment? Now, let me see the hands up. How many of you know that I have to have that? That's about 15%. I think it's important that people realize that we live in a regime of laws like everybody else. We're stewards of a land base that is highly productive and on which we depend for the continuation of the employment of our people. We're running short on time, and I'm going to cut some corners here to allow time for questions. The City Club has taken a position on forest planning. It's included in your economic package. I would like to suggest, and that position, by the way, to remind you, is that the current harvest level should be maintained, provided that is environmentally responsible. I would just like to suggest for your consideration that you think about whether or not to appoint a task force to continue monitoring what's going on in the forest planning process and to provide input to that forest planning process for the benefit of the Forest Service. This is the most prestigious opinion-making body in the state of Oregon. And I suggest to you that this is the most important subject that you will have to deal with in the immediate future. It has to do with the ability of our industry to continue to achieve its potential. And without the federal timber at abundant levels, we're going to have very expensive, high-cost timber. And we can't do our thing with that on our backs. There are some popular myths that I would like to leave you dispelled today. We're not running out of old growth. We need to continue to harvest old growth, and we have 50 billion feet of it permanently in preservation now. We're not wrecking the forest environment through logging and timber management. We operate under the regulations of the Forest Practices Act. We're not in danger of establishing a monoculture because of destruction of the gene pool. The metropolitan area is not isolated from the forest industry's destiny, and we are not a sunset industry. We're enjoying our third record consecutive year. We've been through an extraordinary period of transition since the housing market fell out of bed. We've gone from a housing market of 2,200,000 houses per year to 1/2 of that in a one-year period. We've done some things in our own self-preservation. We've lowered our hourly wage and benefit costs to protect us on down markets. We've invested in modern technology to improve both productivity and recovery from the log. We've improved our management and supervisory effectiveness. We've cut our freight costs, and we've invested in trade promotion for expanded markets. Most importantly, We need the public's assistance to influence our future in a positive way for the benefit of most Oregonians, and we need it now. We need wise forest policy decisions based on common sense and reason and sound research, so that when emotion is cleared away and we're left with sensible policies that permit us to continue the good stewardship of our fabulous productive commercial timberlands, then all Oregonians will benefit. In this way, we can enjoy the values of Oregon's special attributes, anchored by a firm economic underpinning. And that's the best of both worlds. Thank you.